Another key aspect of workplace bullying that we ask about in nearly every national survey is rank, the rank of the perpetrator. Because when the bully is a boss, he or she enjoys enhanced status that makes it much, much easier to threaten a bully target with job loss. You got to be a boss to threaten job loss. Coworkers, on the other hand, have a special knack and a special skill of threatening social exclusion and ostracism, which carries its own sort of pain, albeit physical pain. And it's quite hurtful and harmful, but they cannot exert or impose economic damage like a boss can. In the 2014 survey from WBI, the slight majority of bullies are bosses, 56%. 33% are coworkers, and 11% are subordinates. Now, the higher coworker proportion does not surprise us at all, but the reduced proportion by bosses does. And we're thinking that perhaps this is also an indicator or an index of progress. In a way, maybe the message has been getting out to bosses through employers that they need to simply knock it off, that they need to stop the bullying and curb their aggressive tendencies. So we'll take that also as a form of credit of raising awareness in this country that bullying is an unacceptable form of aggression, and it really has no place as a management tool or technique. It is neither motivation nor inspiration. It is not transactional or transformational. It's totally destructive. It has no place with business. It undermines the mission. It has nothing to do with productivity, and it actually prevents work from getting done. And it's terribly costly. Truth be told, bullies are too expensive to keep. Bully bosses are too expensive to keep. So let's see if we can drive that number of bullies who are bosses down to zero at some point.